ओके, हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू LICD लेक्चर नंबर 32A. टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द पल्स विथ मॉड्यूलेशन एंड एप्लीकेशन ऑफ 555 टाइमर इन मोनोस्टेबल मोड. सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द वन ऑफ द अदर एप्लीकेशन ऑफ 555 टाइमर इन मोनोस्टेबल मोड. सो बिफोर अंडरस्टैंडिंग एंड गोइंग इन टू डिटेल्स, द बेसिक अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ द 555 टाइमर इन मोनोस्टेबल मोड इज एक्सट्रीमली इंपॉर्टेंट. ओके, सो लेट अस कॉन्सेंट्रेट नाउ इन दिस सर्किटरी. ओवर हियर वी हैव सीन दिस इज माई 555 टाइमर सर्किट विच कंसिस्ट ऑफ 3 5 kΩ रजिस्टर्स, 2 comparators, comparator number A and B, RS flip-flop, output buffer, which will invert whatever is present at the input, and discharge transistor, which is used to discharge, the charge across the capacitor, externally connected capacitor. Okay, so it's the same circuit. I'll just show you in the symbolic form. This is the same circuit as the monostable multivibrator. The only difference is that The input trigger pulse, we have a fixed frequency. Input frequency is 1 kHz. So all of you know, in a pulse width modulation, we have a carrier signal and we have a modulating signal. So over here, the trigger inputs are my carrier signal, and my modulating signal of low frequency around 40 hertz is applied to pin number 5. Normally, so far, we have not used pin number 5. It was connected to the ground via a 0.01 microfarad capacitor. You must be knowing it from the earlier diagrams. In this particular case, we are applying a modulating signal at pin number 5. That's the only difference. And the frequency of the trigger input is also known. That is around 1 kHz, which acts as a carrier. So over here, this is my frequency carrier signal. This is a negative going carrier signal ranging from plus 5 to 0 volts, and its frequency is 1 kHz. Okay, this green color one is my modulating signal. Now, this is drawn a little bigger just for over exaggeration. Right now, it is not. Actually, I have just drawn for simplicity a little bigger, because here we can see the voltages are 0 to 5. And here I have just extrapolated, I've drawn expanded view of it. So this scale is not proper, okay? But the concept will be remaining the same. So over here, we have selected a modulating signal which is starting from 3 volts, okay? And its amplitude is 1.5 in the positive and in the negative direction. So that means it can go up 3 volts up by 1.5. That means it can reach 4.5, and it can go below 3 volts by 1.5. That is, it can go to 1.5, okay? So this is above 0 volts. Okay, so this entire signal is a AC as well as a DC signal. This 3 volts is my DC shift to apply to the AC signal. So this is how the modulating signal, and as you can see, it's a low frequency signal. Okay, now this is about the waveforms. Now let's see how do you get a PWM, that is a pulse width modulation output, over here. Okay, so what do we know about the monostable mode is that whenever your output is high, that means my capacitor voltage has not reached 2/3 VCC. So over here, let me just expand it over here. Earlier, since pin number 5 was not used and it was connected to ground via a capacitor, this voltage across pin number 5 was fixed at 3.33 volts, okay? But now it will be not fixed. Actually, it will be varying, okay? So what minimum and maximum value of modulating signal we can have? It can have a minimum value of 1.5 and maximum value of 4.5, as you can see over here, okay? So this 3.33 will not be remaining constant. In fact, it is superimposed with this modulating signal, whose amplitude will vary from 1.5 to 4.5. So it won't remain fixed, okay, over here. So that's the basic difference. So what will happen is the comparator A output is totally depend upon the magnitude of my modulating signal. So accordingly, if the comparator A output, which was pretty much predictable earlier, depending upon the trigger input. Now it also depends upon the magnitude of the modulating signal. So over here, as the magnitude of the modulating signal is going on increasing, as you can see, the pulse width is becoming more and more, as you can see over here. Okay, and as soon as the modulating signal is decreasing again, the pulse width is getting closer and closer. And when it goes below 3 volts, it's becoming even closer. Okay, and again, it is becoming wider when it is when the modulating signal is increasing. So that means what? My output, which is a pulse width modulation, its width is dependent upon the amplitude of the modulating signal and the carrier of my high frequency of my carrier signal. So hence it is called as a pulse width modulation signal. As you can see, the pulse width is dependent upon the amplitude of the modulating signal and the frequency of the carrier signal. Okay, so each pulse is triggered by a negative going pulse, as you can see over here. Okay, so as the magnitude of the modulating signal is increasing over here, my pulse width is more and more, and it is decreasing, the pulse width is also decreasing correspondingly. So that's how it works. Now let's go to the formal the writings over here. So let me just give it complete that in 2 minutes time, and then we will see the simulation also. Okay, I have to reduce this. I hope that this is clear, and this is the symbolic representation of the same. Okay, now let me keep this. Actually, when I saw in the simulation, that picture will be more clear, that how the capacitor voltage is rising right from 1.5 to 4.5. It can charge up to that. Okay, let me change it to 15. Yeah, so your 555 timer is operating in a monostable mode here. The circuit is triggered by the high frequency 1000 hertz negative going trigger pulse. A low frequency modulating signal is applied to the pin number 5, which is the control voltage. And this has effect of modulating the pulse width as the control voltage varies over here. Okay, so what is the working? Let me get back to the diagram. Okay, yeah. So the modulating signal is applied to the pin number 5, as you can see over here. Okay, which is get superimposed on the already existing 2/3 VCC voltage at the inverting terminal of the upper comparator. Here you have it. So voltage at pin number 5 varies from 4.5 to 1.5 instead of just 3.33. That's what I've said over here. Okay, so therefore, as the modulating signal varies in the amplitude, the control voltage level keeps on changing. So over here, this pin number 5 is my control voltage level, that keeps on changing. That means what? This will cause the comparator A output to change frequently. Okay, so depending upon that, the output pulse rate, I mean the output pulse width will change. And it is clear from the output waveforms over here. Let me show you the output waveforms. So these are my, let me reduce in the amplitude. Okay, so these are my output waveforms, the PWM output. So it's clear that the width of the output pulse varies as per the instantaneous value of the modulating signal. So as the modulating signal increases, the pulse width increases. As the modulating signal decreases in amplitude, the pulse width reduces. Okay, so this also causes the capacitor voltage to change as per the control voltage level from 1.5 to 4.5. Okay, so this action give rise to the pulse width modulated wave at the output of the 555 timer. So that's how it is. That's how the PWM signal is generated at the output. Now let's check that this in the LTSpice. Okay, so the circuit is made available. The modulating signal is applied to the pin number 5. This is my control voltage, and it's starting from 3 volts with a magnitude of 1.5 peak. And it's a 40 hertz signal, and this is my trigger pulse. R1 C1 is as it is. So here a modulating signal frequency is 40 hertz, and the trigger which acts as a carrier is around 1000 hertz. Let me simulate this, and that the things will be more clear over here. So I will plot one more plane, and then I will add trace the modulating signal. And then I can also add trace the trigger signal, and lastly but not the least, the output of the 555 timer. So here it is. As you can clearly see, the modulating signal is a low frequency. This blue color trigger pulse, as you can see, if I expand it a little, see, this is your very small width. See, it's a very small divot. It's momentarily going to low, so it's a trigger pulse of very short duration. Okay, so over here, if I show one more plot of the capacitor, the things will be pretty much clear. So this is my modulating signal low frequency, this is my trigger pulse, and as you can see, as the modulating signal is increasing in amplitude, the pulse width is increasing, and when it is decreasing, the pulse width is getting closer and closer. So you can see the output pulse width is modulated completely by the amplitude of the modulating signal. Now let me plot the last plot of the capacitor voltage. You know, so this is my capacitor voltage. As you can see, it's clearly behaving like this. I mean, the minimum value of the modulating signal amplitude is 1.5. So capacitor is, as you can see, capacitor is charging accordingly. Okay, so capacitor voltage is charging accordingly according to the the magnitude of my modulating signal. So this will make the things extremely clear. Okay, earlier what was happening was, let me just bring back to the the control voltage was fixed at 3.33. That's why the capacitor voltage may never increase or decrease beyond 3.33 volts or 2/3 of VCC. But now the control voltage, this rise and fall in the capacitor voltage is due to the modulating signal. Okay, I hope that this doubt is clear now about how the pulse width is obtained at the output. So as you can see, as the capacitor voltage charges and charges to the modulating signal peak value, then the trigger pulse appears and it will instantly discharge, and you will get the output high, output low. And again, when the next trigger pulse comes along, again the capacitor voltage will keep on charging and it will charge to the maximum value of the modulating signal amplitude. And again, when the trigger pulse comes, it will discharge instantaneously after reaching the maximum peak as per the control voltage or the magnitude of the modulating signal. It will discharge instantaneously. It will discharge via this discharge transistor. So all the capacitor voltage will be discharged instantaneously to the ground. Again, at the arrival of the next trigger pulse, the capacitor voltage charges to the peak value of the modulating signal. Remember, that's the only difference. Earlier it was charging to the peak value of the 2/3 VCC, but now it will charge to the peak value of the modulating signal. So that's why this will be the highest charge over here, 4.5. so the capacitor voltage can go, ideally it should go to VCC, but it will go to 2/3 VCC, but to the maximum value of the modulating signal amplitude over here. Okay, hence after the comparator, A state will change and the RS flip-flop state will change and the output will go low. I think that we have seen in the monostable mode. So that's how again it's decreasing, and again the capacitor voltage will behave accordingly. Okay, so this is the working of the pulse width modulation using 555 timer in monostable mode. This was my circuit in LTSpice, and so this was the content of today's first topic for the day, that is pulse width modulation. Okay, so after we have generated the pulse width modulated wave at the pin number 3 of the 555 timer, what are the applications? So typical applications are pulse width PWM signals are used in servos, data loggers. It's also used in quadcopters and electronic speed controller and autopilot system. So these are the particular applications where we can use this PWM output. Okay, this PWM output is extremely important. Okay, I think we have come to our first segment end, that is 32A. And next we will see the next, the application, that is linear ramp generator. Okay, so that's it for this first part. Now we'll soon start with the second part.